If you're an AP chemistry student, you probably know that most of the exam tests fundamental concepts of chemistry that you have to learn by doing, problems that you have to practice, scientific laws that involve equations. The AP exam gives you 2 pages worth of constants and equations. You have to know when to use which equation, and good chemistry students are going to know a lot of them just by having used them all year, but you don't have to memorize them. In this video, I'll tell you the top 7 things you've got to memorize for the AP Chem exam. These aren't all of them, these are my top 7. Before we start, remember to hit that thumbs up button if you get something out of this video. It helps get the word out to the rest of the AP Chemistry world. And even better yet, subscribe to my channel for more chemistry videos. My name is Jeremy Krug, and I've been teaching AP Chem for the past 23 years, and I want you to get the best score you can. Let's get started. Number 7, percent error formula. You're expected to know how to calculate the percent error of a calculation given the calculated answer and the right answer. They don't tell you how to do that on the equation packet, so you have to know this ahead of time. Percent error is equal to the absolute value of the calculated answer minus the correct answer, all over the right answer, times 100. So for example, if the accepted value for an investigation is 0.837 grams, and the calculated value from lab was 0.852 grams, then the error is 1.79%. That equation is not on the equation sheet, so you have to learn that one. Number 6, polyatomic ions. Even though this is a basic one, there are still some AP Chem students that haven't learned the polyatomic ions very well by the time they get to the end of the course. You've got to know these. So if you've gotten to this point without learning the polyatomic ions and their charges, memorize these today. Here are the most common ions that appear on the AP Chem exam. Make flashcards, use a Quizlet, whatever you have to do, but learn those ions. Number 5, simple solubility rules. When you add 2 solutions, you have to know that the ions that would form a soluble compound don't combine to produce a solid. Instead, they remain in solution as spectator ions. It's the combination of ions that form the insoluble compound that make the precipitate. Good students are going to learn all the solubility rules and the exceptions, but the College Board has written the AP exam so that you only need to know a minute fraction of the solubility rules. Any ionic compound containing sodium ions, potassium ions, ammonium ions, or nitrate ions are soluble. So, if you're adding 2 solutions on the AP exam, one of the solutions will have one of those ions. It's the other combination that forms the precipitate. That's all you have to know, but you have to know that those 4 ions are soluble. Number 4, facts about a galvanic cell. At some point on the AP Chem exam, you're going to see a diagram of a galvanic cell, and it will probably look something like this. In order to determine what's happening and where it's happening, you need to know some key facts about galvanic cells. Usually, they give you just enough information to be able to fill in the missing pieces and solve the puzzle. To determine the voltage or potential difference, you're given the equation E cell equals E cathode minus E anode. Total voltage of the cell and the 2 standard reduction potentials, you know any 2 of them, you can figure out the other 1. But the rest of the facts, you have to know. Here are some mnemonic aids that might help you keep all this straight. Red cat and NOx. Reduction takes place at the cathode and oxidation takes place at the anode. Oil rig. Oxidation is losing electrons and reduction is gaining electrons. The cat gets fat. In other words, with metallic electrodes, the cathode always increases in mass. AC, as in air conditioning. Electrons flow through the wire from anode to cathode. And at the salt bridge, anions flow toward the anode and cations flow toward the cathode. You have to know all that. So learn those facts. Number three, thermodynamic favorability. You have to be able to look at the numeric value of a reaction's change in enthalpy, delta H, and its change in entropy, delta S, and determine if a reaction will be thermodynamically favored or not. And they don't give you that little chart. In theory, you could figure it out with the equation delta G equals delta H minus T delta S, but it's just as easy to learn it. If a reaction has a negative delta H and a positive delta S, then it will be thermodynamically favored at all temperatures, since the universe tends to favor exothermic reactions and processes that increase entropy. On the other hand, if a process has the opposite of that, a positive delta H and a negative delta S, then it won't be favored at any temperatures. If a reaction has a positive delta H and a positive delta S, it will be thermodynamically favored at higher temperatures, or more positive temperatures, if it helps you remember that. And the more positive the temperature, the more favored it is. And finally, if a reaction has a negative delta H and a negative delta S, it will be favored at lower temperatures, or more negative temperatures. Number two, integrated rate laws. For kinetics, you have to know how to write a rate law and calculate a rate constant. But most of that is simple algebra. The part you have to memorize is knowing which integrated rate law is which. Now, this is interesting because the equation sheet gives you all the integrated rate laws you'd ever need for this exam. It just doesn't tell you which one is first order, which one is second order, and which one is zero order. Remember, the natural log of concentration is code for first order. 1 over concentration is code for second order. And concentration is code for zero order. If you know how to tell those three apart, that will get you pretty far on the kinetics questions. Number one, molecular geometry. And the number one thing you have to memorize for the AP Chem exam is molecular geometry and bond angles. And to be honest, there's no way around this. You have to know that a steric number of 4, that is 4 slots of electrons around the central atom, has a bond angle of about 109.5 degrees. And you have to know that it's called tetrahedral. And when one unshared pair takes a bonding pair's place, it's called trigonal pyramidal. And if it happens to be 2 unshared pairs, it's called bent. The steric number of 3, or 3 slots of electrons, has a bond angle of about 120 degrees and called trigonal planar. With just 2 slots, it's linear and 180 degrees. For 6 slots, it's 90 degrees and called octahedral. And for 5 slots, it's 90 and 120 degrees and called trigonal bipyramidal. And there are other geometries that have unshared pairs or lone pairs on the central atom that you need to know. So those are the top 7 things to memorize before the AP Chemistry exam. There are some others that you can think of. Pop them down there in the comments. I'd like to see what else you can come up with. Maybe things like hybridization, how to calculate formal charge, Coulomb's law, periodic trends, things that you just have to know, straight up memorization in some cases. Thanks for watching, and I hope you do great on the AP Chem exam. Share this video with a friend and slam that like button if you got something out of this. I hope to see you again here on my channel, and keep learning chemistry.